Hi, this is your host Swapnil Bharti, and welcome to our brand new show, The Source Code, in which we talk to companies who are building great services and products around open source technologies. And today we have with us Rajoshi Ghosh, CEO and co-founder of a company called Hasura. Rajoshi, first of all, welcome to the show. Tell us a bit about what problem you saw in the market that you co-founded Hasura, and also what is the story behind the name?
First off, thank you so much for inviting me and very, very happy to be here. So how Hasura actually came out of a consulting company that a lot of the our you know early team, we were all a part of. We had the grand vision of solving application development and making it easier. We did not, at that point in time, we weren't sure what shape or form it would take. So we sort of went through this journey of building a lot of applications for startups and moved on to, helping large banks kind of move from, monolith setup to microservices, kind of went through that whole journey and kept looking at, building automation tools to help people build fast. So parts of Hasura came from there. So we started Hasura, the company, early in late 2017, and we came out with the product in July. In July is when we launched the Hasura GraphQL engine, which is an open source product. And, so it's been 2 years since the product's been there. And the name is Asura without the H, basically is demon. And that's punning on the word D-A-E-M-O-N, which is the, background processes. And so that's the demon bit of it. And the H is from Haskell, because the core of Hasura is written in Haskell. And so that the H came from there. So that's kind of how, it came together. And that's Hasura. And that's sort of how we built it.
If you look at, when you created a company in 2017, we are in 2020, a lot of things have changed. A lot of new paradigms have come in. A lot of new technologies are coming in. And the way people are consuming or moving their workloads in production to the cloud native world. So for you also, the use cases, the workloads have also changed and evolved. So can you talk about when you started versus where we are now, how much has changed in this space?
We look at the core problem of what we solve as, being the data access problem. And I think a big change that has been happening and it's just accelerating is the number of places your data is. Like, data is siloed in different environments. Your primary data source is, your database. But if you're an enterprise, your data is in your database, your primary system of record, it could be an ERP. And then with the whole Jamstack evolution happening, data is even more fragmented. You have, say, your payment data in Stripe, you have some, your blog data in a CMS, you have a primary data store. So the data sources are getting more and more fragmented. So the data access problem just becomes harder, because as a, API, as sort of a backend developer or an API developer, you have to just do many more integrations to get that data from wherever it's sitting in the hands of the developer. So this is kind of, as we see it, this fragmentation of data across different silos has just been growing because of the number of things that are getting servicified and people getting more comfortable moving more workloads into the cloud. So I think that's sort of been the biggest change in Hasura. That's one of the core problems that we see us solving, and sort of being that piece in the middle that's able to stitch across the different data sources and bring that data in the hands of the API consumers faster.
How does Hasura kind of change or affect the workflow for developers to kind of make it easier for them? Also, we live in this multi-cloud world, so the data not only is different places, it could be in different clouds as well. It could also be on-prem. So workflow really becomes challenging and complicated.
Absolutely, yeah. So you're absolutely right. The data, like I was talking about it being in different systems, it's also actually multi-cloud. So you can think of Hasura as, so if you were not using Hasura, for instance, you're kind of, the piece in the middle that Hasura is solving is tradition. It's like, you have your API server, you have your API gateway, and you have an ORM. So that is the entire piece in the middle that Hasura is kind of replacing. So that's the workflow where, the code that you're writing in the middle is essentially doing everything from your integrations across these different data sources. And like we said, these data sources could be everywhere. Then the performance and security aspect of actually getting that data in the hands of the developers, because you have to, like, access control for who's accessing this data ends up taking in a GraphQL world that's within the GraphQL server for the REST API for every single API. you have to build in those security rules. So there's a lot of code that is written in this middle layer. So that's the workflow that we see changing, because what you do with Hasura is essentially, you know, Hasura is like a service. You just like put it in the middle. It connects to these different data sources. We have the security layer as part of Hasura. So instead of writing these security rules for every single data source, you're configuring it on this UI or through a configuration file. And then, you know, you're able to sort of access that. So that's the workflow that's changing, where you sort of, you know, this sort of performance and security aspect of accessing this data is taken care of by Hasura, where you almost treat this aspect as part of your infrastructure, and then you focus on writing just your business logic, which Hasura sort of lets you integrate with. So that's the workflow change that, you know, we're seeing with the people, with our users and the community who are starting to develop using Hasura.
I used to go to a lot of tech events, you know, but everything has become online web. I don't like the word when companies use the word virtual, because I'm heavily into AR and VR. And virtual event means that I don my VR headset, I can actually walk to your booth, I can touch stuff, I can talk to people, interact with people. That is not happening. So just call it web conference. So let's just get that clear. Now, you organize your users summit, right? What user conference? So first of all, tell me, how was the experience as compared to, you know, event that you would have done before or after that? And what are some of the, you know, feedback you received, some of the lessons you learned, and how does it also affect your next conference?
So I think we are I don't know if lucky is the right word, but basically it was our first user conference, you know. So I think we started off on the web. I'm not going to call it virtual, but we did call it virtual on the website though, so I think the amazing part is, of course, that you have your community join you from everywhere, right? Because when you're an open source community, and you know, this like, we have a really, really thriving community of developers, and the fact that all of them were able to join us irrespective of geography, I think was a huge plus. So I think next year, hoping that, you know, COVID-19 is long gone, we are actually going to have to think about, you know, it's going to be the opposite effect for us. Like, you know, having it in one location automatically means that you're kind of, you are only accessible to people in one geography. So I think I would say, like, conferences perhaps will always have this online web presence in addition to the physical presence, perhaps going forward, because, you know, that's something that we've seen, how people are able to come together. Having said that, we do run some offline conferences like GraphQL events. So I think being able to sort of walk up to somebody and ask a question, I think the platforms are still evolving in terms of how you bring that interaction. People are trying a combination of doing, you know, Slack channels and Discord along with the video, so that you're able to have that communication. We did see a lot of that, but I definitely think there's a lot of improvement, and I know a lot of people are building seriously around creating those experiences. We're in the beginning of it. I think people are like fast tracking their conference setups, but that communication, you know, being able to go up and ask somebody a question, you know, get that organized, that those are things that can still definitely.
Can you talk a bit about what are the, like, products or services that you're offering leveraging open source, and also how do you treat open source community there? Because sometimes what happens, a lot of companies, they offer just free of cost version, or sometimes they offer, you know, open source is, to me, open source solves the day one problem, but what about day two, you know, when you actually, so talk a bit about your product portfolio, service portfolio, and how it leverages and allows so people can play with open source, but they can also become customers.
Everything that's important for you to build your application is in the open source. And the enterprise offering, which is kind of where the services sort of things also come in, which is we bundle support with our enterprise offering. But enterprise offering also comes with, you know, custom integrations, like, you know, your SSO integrations or any kind of APM integrations that you might have. So that comes, and that's all, you know, there's depending on who we're working with, that's the kind of, like, your requests we get in. So we also have, like, SLA based support that goes into that goes into the enterprise model. And then, like, cloud that I mentioned is one is the consumption, the hosting part of it, the no ops part of, you know, just being on the cloud, which also allows us to sort of offer a better experience to our developers. And on top of that, so the consumption-based pricing becomes a big thing. And then the second part of it is because we're hosted like on, because it's a hosted offering, we're able to offer features like, you know, dynamic data caching, which is what is built into the cloud product. And we have enhanced, what we call it, it's like enhanced security. So you can go into production with the open source product, but you know, if you want to set up additional security, if you want to create like allow lists, if you want to, you know, like have monitoring features, you want to have integrations with your other setup. So typically production workloads when your apps are critical, right? When your apps are, when Hasura sits in a critical app and it's not a hobby project, then the features around cloud are something that become useful to you. So we do have people, you know, the hobbyists who are hosting, self-hosting Hasura, and who can, you know, you can wire up these things yourself and you can run in production, right? So it's not kind of stopping you that way, but people like the no ops setup and the out of the box features that, you know, cloud offers, where you want to kind of have those portions taken care of for you in the cloud and the enterprise version. So that's kind of how we look at it. Anything build goes in open source, anything in sort of critical production setup in especially around performance and security kind of goes in the is in our cloud offering.
Rajashree, thank you so much for taking your time out today and explaining what Hasura is doing. I look forward to talk to you again, because I'm pretty sure that there are a lot of things that are in the pipeline there, and there is a lot to talk about. So thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. I really enjoyed this chat. Thanks. Look forward to being here again.